Okay, yeah, I hope everyone is back. So we'll continue with the second part of Eddie's lecture, and we'll start with a question on Slack. And it is it possible to study these non-Lagrangian n equal to 3 superconformal theories in the ADS-CFT setup? If so, would they be related to a supergravity with 12 supercharges in the bulk? I'm familiar with a supergravity a bit. I'm trying to see if there is a place where they connect.
So the answer is yes, but for more, let's talk on because it's really not the topic of the lecture, but the answer is yes, yes, yes.
Yeah, I mean, I felt we could just discuss on Slack. Yeah.
Yes, yes.
Yeah, thanks.
Fantastic. So as you see, I am already cheating a tiny little bit, and I wrote a few more things while you were on your break. So now I want to construct representations. And well, it's very easy. First, we begin by defining what the superconformal primaries are, so SCP. And we define them as the highest weight states of the multiplet. And we define the highest weight state by acting with all the Qs and all the S's and getting zero. That's what it is. And now, note maybe something very nice. I will write it with green. Note that if you have this condition, immediately by using this nice little equation here, check, what happens? You get that K, the big K, on the highest weight state is zero. So when some gadget is a superconformal primary, it is also a conformal primary, CP, conformal primary. Good, so this is very good because, they will be the beginning of the conformal multiplets also. I am a little bit assuming, I have to say, that you know what conformal multiplets are. But okay, anyway, if there is a problem with a little bit of homework, this can be made fine. So now, in order to make the multiplets, we just act with the Qs. Superconformal. And when you act with the Qs, there are two things you can do. One thing you can do is that you can act with the Qs in a symmetrized way. But, well, this, symmetrized Qs give momenta. So symmetrized Qs give momenta. So I get conformal descendants. And the other thing that I can do is that I can anti-symmetrize and precisely because I anti-symmetrize and I have a finite number of Qs, I get a finite multiplet. As opposed to symmetrized action that gives conformal descendants, which can be infinite. So with anti-symmetrized action, I get a finite multiplet. And this is what I am going to be calling a superconformal multiplet. Or a representation. And maybe we can make a little drawing of that just for the fun of it, just we can. So the superconformal multiplet will look something like this. Here there will be the highest weight. Here there will be the lowest weight. This will all be very finite. At each point, when I do symmetrized action, over the Qs, I'm going to get momenta everywhere. So I have a finite little square that is my super conformal multiplet, and the whole thing goes to infinity up, and these are all the conformal descendants. Is this good and clear? Now, yes?
Question. Did you say there could be an infinite number of conformal descendants?
Yeah, yeah. Because with momenta, you can act as many times as you like.
But I thought there'd be some kind of like lower scaling dimension that would, like.
I'm doing this movement with my hands. I don't know. You can go up. You cannot go down.
Oh, okay. Yeah, yeah. Okay is the lowering operator. Okay.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. Fantastic. So now, having said that, there is another thing that I want to say. What are the types of multiplets? So first of all, the first thing that can happen is that all the Qs that you have, when they act on the highest weight states and you take the norm is positive. If this is what happens, the multiplet, maybe with red, is long or generic. However, there is another thing that can happen. So for some Q, one is enough. When you compute this, you get a zero. When this thing happens, you have what is called a null vector. And you have to kick it out of the multiplet. I am not going to explain the details of how this is done, but this is a very well-defined procedure. And by doing that, you get a short multiplet. So we have generic or long multiplets and short multiplets. And let me write a tiny little bit more so that you can also do the homework 3 that is written there. So I will use the radial quantization and I will write this. I will write this as, and maybe I want to write a square here, as this. So you open it up, you use this equation, our favorite equation, where the conformal dimension appears, the symmetry appears, and the spin appears. And the moment you do that, equal to zero, this leads you to some function of the delta of the highest weight state, the spin, and the symmetry. Equal to zero. And this thing is what is called the shortening condition. And this is what I want you to derive as a homework. I will write it out, but please derive yourself to really learn how to use this equation and play around. And then what we do in life, practically, when we have something to figure out, you give me an operator and I test if and if which shortening condition it satisfies. So that's how it works. So this function is very important. Are there questions? So if there are no questions, then let's do a tiny little bit more detail. Above I said very generically that there are two types of multiplets, short and long. Let's be a little bit more specific. In fact, there are three types of shortening. And just because they are three, let's just stupidly call them ABC. By the way, what I am doing now is that I am following the notation of Dolan and Osborne, which is the classic paper on this subject. This is where they did it for the first time. So with A, we denote long multiplets. There is no shortening. D, Then we go to B type, and this is a type that we can only use if the highest weight state has the property that it has zero spin, at least the J1, the one of them. So I act with L and I get zero. So if this is the case, I can do the following. I can act with a Q like this, where the index A here, A alpha, sorry, is an open index. Just by looking at this, you see with your eyes that in fact these are two Qs, because I can do it with both alpha equal to plus and minus, right? So this immediately tells me that I have two Qs killing this. So this is immediately telling me, whoops, that this is a 1/4 BPS condition. Let me remind you that n equal to 2 theories have 8 Qs. So 2 out of 8 is 1/4. That's why it's called 1/4 BPS. And by the way, the same thing you can do, and maybe let's put a nice gray color. You can call B bar the condition where the J2 is equal to zero, and there the Q tilde alpha dot on the highest weights is zero. And again, it's a 1/4 BPS condition where both alpha dot is equal to plus minus does this job. Now, again, part of the homework will be that you derive the shortening condition when this is the case, when the J1 or the J2 is zero. And you will find out that the answer is delta is equal to 2r minus or plus little r. So f is equal to delta minus 2r plus minus little r, okay? So please derive this. And all in all, when you look at this a tiny little bit slowly, you can count that there are four types of this type of B conditions, because this Q in fact has an index I, so they can be, I can act with a Q1, with a Q2, with a Q tilde 1, and with a Q tilde 2. So let me write in words that there are four such conditions. B1, B2, B bar 1, B bar 2. Are there questions? So if no, I will go to the C. C type conditions. And C type conditions are basically cases where this doesn't hold, at least at the beginning. And you have a Q with a spinor index that acts on the highest weight, that also has a spinor index, and you can contract them. So this is one linear combination of Qs. So this is an 1/8 BPS condition. Good. And again, as we wrote before, there are four such conditions. We call them C1, C2, C bar 1, C bar 2. And the only other thing that I need to write for you is that the delta is equal to 2 plus 2r minus plus little r. So the only, and I forgot something else. There's also this 2j. Okay, here I don't write because this can be 1 or 2 depending on if it's the C or the C bar. And I mean, hopefully you will derive this in your homework by doing what I said before. So having said these things, it was a tiny little bit technical, but the technical piece was just this half a page. We can now basically classify completely all possible representations of n equal to 2, of the n equal to 2 superconformal algebra. And this was done in this paper. And the only thing you need to do, you set up a nice Mathematica file that imposes all these different conditions in all possible combinations that this can be done. That's the job. This is a finite problem. With a bit of pain, you do it, and that's it. You basically just need to be good in Mathematica or whatever other program you are using. Now, I am not going to go through, of course, all the multiplets because this would be like a week's course or something. But I want to go through a couple of short ones that are important. And even more, some of them we will use on Thursday for the spin chains. So I will go through the shortest possible representations, which are half BPS. So how do you get half BPS? We had a quarter BPS and 1/8 BPS. For example, if you take 2/4 BPS, clearly you make a half BPS, right? There are two ways to do this. One way to do this is take two type B conditions of the same chirality and impose them at the same time. And this is what I denote with this notation here. This can be written in this way. Q with the SU2R symmetry index acts on the highest weight state and it gives zero. And this is true for all alpha and all I. So the moment you do that, first of all, this multiplet is called, oops, I need to change, ER. So you already see the symbol. I wrote it before when I was talking about the marginal deformations. This is a specific hub BPS multiplet for which the highest weight state always has delta, the conformal dimension is equal to the little r, to the U1 r charge. The SU2 of the highest weight state is zero, and also the spin is zero. These operators, let me give an example for theories with a Lagrangian description. By the way, let me maybe just write this to be nice. There is the ER, and of course there is the E bar R, where the opposite things hold. Like this, or maybe the most nice way to write it is to write like this. Absolute value of R. So in theories with a Lagrangian description, I can write for you generators that do this job. And these are these guys, trace phi to the L, and trace phi bar to the F. And you know, if you have a Lagrangian description, these are classified and these are all and there is nothing else that does this job. And this is very important. First of all, these are called Coulomb branch operators. They are in one-to-one correspondence with Coulomb vacua. So this is the way you can enter Cyber-Witten theory and all of these other n equal to two things that maybe you have heard. If not, just take with you that this is extremely important. And let me also write a couple of important cases. So if you take E1, so when delta is equal to r is equal to 1, what we get is the vector multiplet. And maybe with red, with each equation of motion. If you don't know what I mean, you have to do the homework to see this. Then another very important case is the case I talked about before when I talked about the marginal deformations, is the case where delta is equal to r is equal to 2. This trace phi squared guys, when I act on them with four supercharges, the other ones though you have to act with, what you get is a marginal deformation. So if you can tell me how many E2 multiplets a theory has, you know what is the dimension of the conformal manifold. And this, as I said already before, can be done by computing the index. So this is something very, very, very well understood. Fantastic. Now we go to the second way to do the things. So we take two type B conditions, but of the opposite chirality. So for example, take B1 and take B bar 2. When you do this, so this is how we write it explicitly, the shortened BPS condition. When you will do your homework, you will discover that, first of all, a name is this. This is how we label these states. This is the BPS condition you will derive, and everything else is zero. These operators are also very important, and these operators are called of Higgs type. And as I said before, for the Coulomb vacua, they are in one-to-one with a Higgs vacua. Yeah, and this is all also extremely important. And there is a whole other branch of things that one can do that starts from this. Like very beautiful modern developments. Let me give examples. So I can start with a B1 half. This is the hypermultiplet. So you can derive it also like this. Another thing that I can do, oh, maybe you shouldn't see the things below, is the B1 multiplet, a gadget that has R is equal to 1, which in the notation that I am using is a triplet of the SU2 symmetry. And well, if you remember what I have been writing, I can write you immediately down an example of this. I can write. So when I write this bracket, I mean symmetrized. So take the squark with I again, remember the SU2R symmetry, it's a doublet. Symmetrize, you get this measure. This is also known as moment map. Maybe you know this, maybe not, but it doesn't matter. It's a name. So this operator is precisely the highest weight state of this multiplet. And maybe you recognize it because maybe when you learn supersymmetry, you have solved for the F and the D term conditions. So the top component of this SU2 multiplet, it's a triplet, the top component and the bottom component, they give you the F and the F bar, auxiliary fields, and the middle component is part of the D. Now, when your theory has a flavor symmetry, let's say, for example, a UNF. What I am writing here, I am omitting the SU2R symmetry indices. They always go like this. I don't repeat that. So here I am writing only the flavor indices, I and J, from 1 to NF. And with A, I denote the color indices from 1 to N. So when you look at this object, this satisfies this condition. So it's the highest weight component of the B hat 1 multiplet. And then when I act with two supercharges on it, I get something that has conformal dimension 3. And this is precisely the flavor current. By the way, remember that the cues, they cannot change the flavor structure, the indices. So that's why when I have an object, maybe let me write in words so that you can have it. So this is a color contracted. This is the A, right? Singlet. But flavor joint object. What I get is a current with in the adjoint representation of the flavor group, which is the flavor current. And in fact, this is another little theorem that if you have an n equal to 2 superconformal field theory, the global currents, they can only belong in this multiplet. There is no way to have a global current that belongs in any other multiplet. There is a little star here for their symmetry currents. They are in another multiplet, but we will talk about them in a second. Okay, so. I write here except currents, but they will come in a second. So that's extremely important. And theories like superconformal QCD, they have only this B hat multiplet, but other theories like the elliptic quiver that we were looking at before, they can have B hat R with higher R. But it's not guaranteed that this higher multiplet will appear. You have to actually check, either by computing the superconformal index or by doing in one loop calculation or something else. Now, one last short multiplet, just because I owe you basically this. We said that we are looking for 1/2 BPS states, shortening conditions, and we used the B's, which were 1/4, but there are also the C that they are 1/8. So how is it possible with 1/8 to make 1/2 BPS? Well, put all of them together. And that's what I did here. We put all of them together. And by combining all the possible conditions that we have above, we get that this should be the conformal dimension of the highest weight state. It should be 2 plus the spin and nothing else. And generically, this is a multiplet for general spins that contain higher spin operators, and only free theories can have it. But when you take the spins to be 0, so when you take what is called C hat 0, 0, so this is the J1 and the J2, they are 0. This is a very special, very important multiplet. It starts with the highest weight states that has delta is equal to 2. And in fact, I will write it for you because it's very special also. It has a special name, T calligraphic, and it's this. When I write here M1, I mean that this is an SU2R symmetry singlet. So instead of doing this thing that I did, that I symmetrized, well, I contract with epsilon tensor, and that's how I get the singlet. So acting on this gadget with Qs, you get a bunch of extremely important things in physics. So you get the stress energy tensor, you get the asymmetry currents, you get the supersymmetry currents, you get all the conservation laws. They are all descendants. of this guy T. And this is extremely important because when you want to derive basically anything you would want to derive that is a correlation function with stress energy tensors or are symmetric currents, you use the fact that it is in these multiplets and you can play tricks and basically you can derive amazing things with this. I mean, you can ask me things, but anyway, so this we will not use very much in these lectures, but I really wanted you to know this because it's super, super, super important. And part of your homework will be check for yourself that indeed these guys and then conservation laws are indeed in this multiplet when you set the spin to be to go to zero. Are there questions? If there are no questions, I will tell you just like a little comment. So here I studied for you n equal to 2 superconformal algebra representation theory, but you can do the same thing for the n equal to 4. And when you do the same thing for n equal to 4, at the beginning you think you should have more possibilities, but in the end, because SU4 has an epsilon tensor, epsilon ABCD, you use this gadget and you discover that in fact, we don't have so many possibilities. There is only one type of 1/2 BPS multiplet for n equal to 4. And that's, okay, this multiplet, this is some very strange and ugly notation that Dolan and Osborne invented. This is the SU4 Dynkin labels. But anyway, the only thing that I actually want you to know is this, that the shortening condition is delta is equal to P, where P is here, the second of the Dynkin labels, which is basically the, if you write in an SO6 language, is how many fundamentals you have. And all the protected operators you know and love, when you study n equal to 4, I don't know, when we will do the spin chains and everything, these are all in here. So this is a great thing to know. And maybe also you can take a look in the notes. I also tell you how this decomposes in n equal to 2 multiplets. This is a very cool thing that when you know, you can play extra games. Great. And maybe I can even make one more comment. So I decided there is another very, very important aspect about representation theory of superconformal algebras that I am not going to talk. I think I have it very nicely in the notes. It's called multiplet recombination. So up to now, what I have done, I have just enumerated for you shortening conditions. And this is great because when operators are in short multiplets, they are protected. They don't gain corrections, you know, with anomalous dimensions, basically. But, well, is this always the case? So you can go through and ask, this is again a group theory question, and you can just check all the possibilities. Is it ever possible that short multiplets will come together and will recombine into a long multiplet? So this exists, and you can read it in the notes. And when this can happen, then the multiplets can in fact gain anomalous dimensions. So if you know these recombination rules, you can in fact know about the dynamics of theories. But I will leave it to that. And but I want to stress that this is very important, and maybe if you care about it, you can ask me on Slack. And like really, if you really know how to use this, you can do some very magical things. You can even compute anomalous dimension just by playing with representation theory. So I will just say this and I will leave it to further questions on Slack. Great. So now there is one last topic I want to explore with you, and I am happy for today, which is the orbifolds. So I said before in my landscape introduction that basically the best way, I mean, I said the good way, but basically the best way to get a lot of n equal to 2 superconformal theories is by orbi folding n equal to 4 super Young Mills, and then further marginally deforming. And the reason why this is great is because orbi folds, they are integrable. We know their gravity dual is very nice, and they have these inheritance theorems. So we can, we immediately know certain quantities because they are inherited from n equal to 4. So there is, you know, there is, you have to calculate way less. And then maybe the only thing that you need to know is, for example, if you want to end to do ADS-CFT, what this marginal deformation corresponds in the gravity side. But this is also something we know. So let's explain really how to do these orbi folds. And the way I know best to describe it in a very, very visual way is the following. So we will go to type 2B string theory. So this, I'm thinking about that I'm in the 10D target space of type 2B string theory. And I place a stack of N D3 brains in these 10 dimensions. I put them here in the 0, 1, 2, 3. So these crosses mean that the D3 brain lives there. And these are the transverse directions where the D3 is a point. If you just do this, first of all, you immediately recognize that here the symmetries of the problem is an SO6 in the transverse directions, which is precisely the R symmetry of n equal to 4 super Young Mills. And you see also that you have these rotations here, which is the Lorentz group of n equal to 4 super Young Mills, which is great. In fact, we can even do more. We can even talk about supersymmetry. Let me do it for fun. Why not? If you do it, you should do it if you can. So when you place a D3 brain in type 2B string theory, you also need to write the Gravitino equation. And okay, I am going to spare you the details, but you get a condition like this. Type 2B has 32 supercharges. This condition kills half of it, so you end up with 16 supercharges, which is precisely how much n equal to 4 has. Great. Now I want to go down to n equal to 2, so I need to do something further to break supersymmetry. And let's break supersymmetry with a red color. So I will do a ZK orbifold. And okay, just because I know the answer, I will put the orbifold to act here. And this is why I had this line already there before. So the moment I do this and I put this extra orbifold, what happens in life is that this SO6 or SU4 breaks, and it breaks down to a U1 or SO2 of rotating 4 and 5. And here I will write, maybe I can first write it and then say. So my orbifold condition is this. This is K, this little guy there. And this is minus. This is some type of a cone, right? So what happens here is, in fact, I have rotations only on the circle of the cone, which is an SO3 or the SU2 R symmetry. So these are my symmetries, the way they look, very geometric in the type 2B string theory. Nice, no? And when I do this parametrization, I can define very nicely these two scalars. Now this will be complex. So x6 plus ix7 and x8 plus ix9 holomorphic scalars. And these will be charged under this SU2 because this is where I rotate. And these are my hypermultiplets in an n equal to 2 language. And I can also define a z, which is again in the same way, x4 plus ix5, which is not charged under the SU2, but it is charged under the U1. Maybe I can have another color. And this is in the vector multiplet, in the n equal to 2 vector multiplet. So this is how I see all of my scalars just from the 10-dimensional picture. And by the way, for example, where is the gauge field? Well, the gauge field is fluctuation of the strings here, right? So this transverse stuff is the scalar fluctuations, and the longitudinal give the gauge fields. And with supersymmetry, you get the rest. And by the way, precisely now that I did the supersymmetry counting for D3 brains, now I can do the supersymmetry counting for D3 brains with an orbifold. So with a ZK, what happens in life is that there is a further condition which breaks the 16 down to 8 of the n equal to 2 theories. So this is also how supersymmetry works. If you know this, you are almost done. And I will write this in words because this is very important. The way, the orbifold acts on the coordinates of the target space of, which is this. So this is how it acts on X and Y, and it doesn't act on Z, or you read it off from the picture. The same way it acts on the fields. So you can really think of this as an equation where X and Y are not just the coordinates, but are the fields. Good? Yes. The way the orbifold acts, the same way. Now, here comes now the thing that I didn't tell you. Let's do it with red. The only extra thing you need to know is that the fields have indices. Color indices. And these are the, in string theory, these are the Chan Patton labels of the open strings. How should we treat them? That's the only thing I need to tell you, and you know everything. So here, I made some very nice pictures for you. This is why it's very nice to use an iPad. So we begin. Let's look first at this part, this part of the picture, which where we are drawing n equal to 4 super young Mills with an SUN. So there, the field content, it comes from open strings, right? That stretch from whatever one brain to another. And these are precisely, you can think of the matrices of the SUN fields precisely in this way. Then you do the orbifold. And the orbifold, you should really think of it like a mirror. So it's a mirror that takes these stacks of ND3 brains and creates K images of this. Maybe I should write it with some... whatever green, K images. So this is 1, 2, ta ta ta, K. K images of ND3 brains. Now, when I am like this, I have the option one, to have open strings within a stack. And these are going to give you my n equal to 2 vector multiplets with SUN. But on the top of that, I also have strings that can stretch from one stack to another. And these are going to be precisely, because I go from one color group to another, by fundamental hypermultiplets. And this is maybe a nicer picture. So I take x and y, I go to these transverse directions here where the orbifold ducts, and I make this nice little picture. Okay, I have pulled everything out a little bit. So normally you should plot everything here in the center, but what I do is that I Higgs a little bit so that I can make a nice picture, and you can see how the bifundamentals, they go from one stack to another, from one stack to another. And if you look at this picture for more than 1 minute, you will immediately recognize, and this is a part of your homework to make it perfect, that this is precisely the field content of the n equal to 2 elliptic quiver I was drawing before in the lecture. If you can learn this, you are amazing. And this is in a very intuitive way, I think. This is, for me, this is my favorite way to understand it. Let me now tell you formally how to do this.
Eli, if you could wrap it up in like 5 minutes.
In 2 minutes, I will be done.
Okay, cool.
So formally, the way we do it is the following. We define an operator tau, which is a matrix that is diagonal. So this is the unit matrix that is n by n. E to the 2 pi I divided by k, dot, 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 e to the 2 pi I, k minus 1 divided by k. We define this matrix. Then we take all n equal to 4 fields and uplift them to kn by kn matrices. Because as we said, the fact that you have the orbifold is like a mirror. It's like doing the method of images that you learned in electromagnetism when you were a grad student. And the moment you do that, we can now finally write very formally with a recipe how this condition will look at the level of the fields that will take in account also the fact that they have the Chan-Paton labels. And then that's just this. This is for the Z. For the Z, we said that the orbifold doesn't act on this. So this is what you are supposed to do. You should impose this equation. Then for the X, you impose this equation. So this is what we had before, but now we also put this projector. And for the Y, so you write this equation, and when you solve it, you find this. So this is diagonal. If you see, this is the object that the orbifold didn't act on. And these are the two fields on which the orbifold did act. And they become off. So this is the diagonal with the zeros here. It is off diagonal, and there is a little guy here in the edge, and the opposite for this guy. So here is a diagonal with the zeros, the first off and one up. And yes, if you look at this field content very carefully, this is precisely the correct field content of an elliptic quiver. And homework 4 is to really clean this up and really convince yourself that this is correct. I have written, I will give you these notes. I have written here the homework, so you can look at it. So I think this is it from me. I'm done. Questions?
Yeah, I don't see any in Slack, but maybe if there's questions, you can just put them in Slack and then discuss online.
Fantastic. I will go later. I will go on Slack and I will see what is there and I will try to reply to all of the questions.
Okay, great. Then I guess I would invite you all to unmute yourself and thank Ellie for this first half of her lectures.